Hi and welcome to part 5 of my video playlist about the best methods to acylate amines. In this presentation, I'll show you two alternatives to the more conventional acylating reagents, namely acylations with carbon monoxide and oxidative acylations with aldehydes. There are only few situations where these strategies do make sense, because the scope of carboxylic acid-derived acylating reagents is huge, as is our knowledge about acylation reactions. Anyway, occasionally, acylations with carbon monoxide can offer an inexpensive alternative worth considering. At the end of the video, I'll also give you some references with still further, more exotic acylation alternatives. One strategy to use carbon monoxide in acylations is the carbonylation of an organopalladium or rhodium compound, followed by nucleophilic displacement of the metal by an amine. These reactions only require catalytic amounts of noble metal. Then, amines can be formulated directly with carbon monoxide, and numerous catalysts have been developed for this purpose. Carbon monoxide is far less expensive than formic acid and therefore the reagent of choice for large-scale formulations. This is an example of the use of ammonium carbamate as a synthetic equivalent of ammonia in a palladium-catalyzed aminocarbonylation of 3-bromopyridine. No autoclave was required and a high yield of nicotinamide was obtained. There are many ways to generate the required intermediate organopalladium or organorhodium compounds. One possibility is the hydroformylation of an alkene, as in this example. No phosphine ligand and only 0.1% of rhodium chloride was required to attain a good yield of mostly the linear amide. Also, alkynes could be converted into acrylamides with a similar strategy. In this case, however, more additives and catalysts were required. Despite this complexity, a high yield of substituted acrylamide was obtained. As alternative to gaseous carbon monoxide, which requires strict safety provisions and experienced personnel, carbon monoxide can also be generated during the carbonylation reaction from a suitable precursor. One of these are metal carbonyls, for instance molybdenone carbonyl, as shown here. Again, with the aid of a palladium phosphine catalyst, a rather unreactive aryl chloride was converted into an amide. Still easier to handle is chloroform, which can also serve as carbon monoxide source when treated with alkali hydroxides. Only 3 equivalents of chloroform were sufficient to carbonylate an aryl bromide in 71% yield. No extensive saponification of the ester occurred, probably because of the poor solubility of cesium hydroxide and toluene. A further precursor of carbon monoxide is carbon dioxide. Hydrogenation of the latter in the presence of amines can lead to the formation of formamides, as in this example. The reaction temperature was quite high, but only 0.02% of an iron-based catalyst was sufficient to obtain a good yield of formamide. Carbon monoxide can also be used to prepare alpha-ketoamides and oxalic acid amides. More than 2 carbonylations, though, do not usually occur because vicinal triketones are very unstable and readily decarbonylate. Even alpha-keto acid derivatives are thermally labile and often undergo clean decarbonylation upon heating. In this example, the twofold carbonylation already took place at 60 degrees Celsius and a high yield of oxalamide was obtained. So, what are the main problems of these carbonylation reactions? One important side reaction is the twofold carbonylation shown on the previous slide. If only a single carbonylation is the aim, small amounts of ketoamides can be annoying because these will have similar properties as the target amide and can be difficult to remove from the main product. Twofold carbonylations can be suppressed by avoiding a large excess of carbon monoxide or by lowering its pressure. Then, traces of copper salts can accelerate twofold carbonylation, as do organic bases such as DAPCO or DBU. Bulky phosphines slow down the reaction of the amine with the intermediate acyl complex and thereby also promote the formation of ketoamides. Then other nucleophiles present in the reaction mixture may also react with the intermediate acyl complex. In this example, the large excess of potassium hydroxide led to the formation of benzoic acid as the main product. Biaryls are a further common byproduct of palladium-catalyzed transformations of aryl halides. One further potential side reaction is the formation of a symmetric urea from the starting amine. This requires some additional oxidant, for instance oxygen. In this example, sulfur was used and a high yield of urea resulted. A further alternative to the acylation with carboxylic acid derivatives is the oxidative acylation with aldehydes. Acetates and hemiacetates are powerful hydride donors and can therefore be oxidized easily to esters or amides by hydride abstraction. An alternative mechanism would be at hydroxylation of the amine, followed by elimination of water from the intermediate N-hydroxyhemiaminal. Most reported examples are based on the use of tert-butyl hydroperoxide as oxidant, and peroxides can both act as hydride acceptors and also hydroxylate amines. Thus, the precise mechanism may vary from case to case. In this example, no catalysts were required, and a slight excess of tert-butyl hydroperoxide was sufficient to bring about a complete conversion of the starting materials. Acetonitrile is a particularly good solvent for such reactions because it is highly resistant toward oxidation and sometimes activates peroxides, as for instance in the so-called Peyne oxidation. In this example, a reactive aldehyde was converted into an amide by treatment with saccharin as a synthetic equivalent of ammonia. As oxidant, tert-butyl hydroperoxide was used and the oxidation was catalyzed by a titanium salt. I find it surprising that saccharin, despite its high chemical stability, can act as ammonia source. At least it can be dosed more accurately than ammonia. This is an example of a copper-catalyzed oxidative acylation of a base label amine hydrochloride with benzaldehyde. Two chloroethylamines tend to form aceridines, but the acylation was fast enough in this case. Also, the product would probably cyclize upon prolonged treatment with a base, but this did not occur here. Aliphatic aldehydes are sensitive toward bases and quickly form aldol addition and condensation products. This was probably the main reason for the lower yield of the second reaction on this slide. In this example, a preformed imine was oxidized by air. The reaction was brought about by one equivalent of sodium cyanide and probably proceeded by intermediate formation of an aminonitrile. Its oxidation, however, somehow consumed cyanide because with less than one equivalent of cyanide, no complete oxidation was achieved. The cyanoimine formed as byproduct could also be transformed into the target amide by treatment with aqueous sodium hydroxide. Here are some more examples of acylations with carbon monoxide, aldehydes, and carbon dioxide. These can also be found in the description of this video. In addition to aldehydes, also alcohols and even some alkanes can be directly converted into amides by treatment with oxidants and an amine. Other, more exotic acylating reagents include polyhaloalkanes, alpha-bromo-nitroalkanes and orthoformates. There are hundreds of methods to prepare amides from amines, but only few have a broad scope and make economic sense. I hope that with this video playlist you got a good overview and starting point to find the best conditions for your target amide.